Good morning, everybody. Very warm welcome to worship this morning. Please sit down. Yes. It's I know, probably going to be too warm now. Because we've all got our coats on because we thought, yeah. Yes. yes, as it does seem that the new boiler is working. praise the Lord, which is lovely to have. We've got in just at the beginning of winter, so we know we will be warm for the whole of this winter, God willing. yes, a very warm welcome. As you can see, we have bread at the side. Do please help yourselves at the end of the service if you like to take any of the bread. We do have shoe boxes and leaflets for the shoe box collection, which I think are through in the entrance. And there was one more thing. My mind has gone blank. This screen isn't working. Yes, that's true. This screen is not working. It will be working next week, hopefully. Yes. And there was one more thing, and I'm sorry, I can't remember it at the moment. If I do remember, I'll tell you later. But a big congratulations to Mr. and Mrs. Annals. lovely to have them back with us this week, yes. right. I'm sorry, I can't remember the other notice. I should have written it down. Okay. Right. Gathering prayer. Let us pray. God of friendship, you are our life's companion, a guest in our homes, and our host in this place and all the world. May we always be eager for your company, and as we meet you here today, may we be open to your transforming presence. Amen. We come to you, O Lord, you who call us by name. May we encounter you today, and in doing so, be transformed in how we see you, in how we see others, in how we see ourselves. In your name we pray. Amen. And now we all sing, All Hail the Power of Jesu's Name. Thank you. I have just remembered the other notice. It's not in the notices this week, but it's the first Saturday of the month, this coming Saturday, so there will be a prayer meeting at 9:45 in here for about an hour for anybody who's able to join us. And now prayers of adoration and confession. Let us pray. All loving God, we worship you today. We acknowledge your greatness, confessing we cannot understand your ways, but we know that they are wonderful. We bring you all our praise, joining our voices with your children around the world, lifting our hearts and faces to you. You, God of our lives, our hearts, our world, we bless your name today. Amen. Gracious Lord, who sees all, you know all that we hide in our hearts. We lay before you all the things that dishonour you and us, acknowledging the damage they cause. We turn from hate and greed and pride. We ask that you would restore us and renew us, transforming our lives by the words and actions of your Son, Jesus, and cleansing us with your Holy Spirit, through whom you make your home in us. Amen. The God who called us, calls us still, cleansing our hearts and renewing our minds. We delight in knowing that we are forgiven, that we can turn away from wrongdoing, that we can start afresh today. In God's great love, we choose to live differently. For Jesus' sake, amen. Now, Alison is going to come and talk.
Okay, good morning. Can you hear me? Is that all right? Excellent. Okay, I'm going to give you a scenario now, and I want you to notice what your initial response is. Okay, so I want you to imagine that after church, you go through to coffee, and either I come up to you or someone else comes up to you and says, I'm coming round with you from church for a coffee. What's your first thought? Apart from, no, you're not. Okay, what I want you to do, because you're all spread out, I want you to tell some people around you. So turn to the people around you, or if you sat on your own, shuffle in and find somebody and tell them honestly what would your first response be. If you don't have a house, imagine they're coming to play in your bedroom. Or something like that. So shuffle around, find someone to talk to, find out what their initial response would be if somebody suddenly invited them round for coffee. Get up and move, off you go. I don't like to stop you chatting because you are all having a lovely chat, but you can carry on chatting later. Is anyone willing to share, other than no, you're not, what their response would be? Good luck. Yeah. Viv. Excellent, yes. So some of you might actually be looking forward to someone coming around for a bit of a natter. I always used to panic before I got married, because I don't drink milk, that if anyone said that, I then would go into a blind panic thinking, where's the nearest shop? Where's the milk? So that might have been your thought. Who thought, oh, the house is an absolute tip? See, when I planned that, I thought that's what I would think. But I woke up, I didn't notice the hour, and I woke up really early, so the house is vaguely tidy for once. Who thought my bedroom is impassable and you couldn't actually walk across the floor? I'm not looking at anybody in particular. Yeah. Yeah. We all have different responses. And today we're going to hear about somebody who got a sudden invite for somebody coming round. Anyone guess what the Bible story today might be? Somebody who suddenly gets an unexpected guest popping round and inviting themselves for tea. Come on. Andy. It might be Zacchaeus, Zacchaeus, how do you say his name? Who knows? Yes. You're going to find out about Zacchaeus. Zacchaeus is up a tree when Jesus goes past and says, I'm coming round for tea. Now, the Bible doesn't tell us exactly what Zacchaeus thought at that moment in time. He possibly did think, my house is a tip. He possibly did think, I haven't got anything to eat or to drink. Or possibly he thought, great, I could really do with a catch up. Or possibly he thought, he's going to notice that I've not really got any friends. Or possibly he thought, he's also going to notice that I've been cheating money out of people. All those thoughts might have gone through Zacchaeus's head. But what's important is that Jesus invited himself into Zacchaeus's life, and Zacchaeus welcomed him in his life. And Jesus still does that today. He says to us, I want to be welcomed into your life, and I want you to welcome me into your life. And even though some of us might say, well, I did that years and years ago, we still have to keep doing it, don't we? It's not a one-off thing. We have to keep saying, yeah, I want Jesus to be part of my life. And for Zacchaeus, it made a huge difference to his life. And for us, each time we say to Jesus, yeah, I want you to be part of my life, it needs to make a difference. So we've got a challenge for today. Well, a challenge for the week, because if we challenge ourselves for longer than a week, we tend to not do it, don't we? After a week, you lose the momentum. So for this week, I want you to think, if I welcome Jesus into my life, what difference might it make? So it might make a difference that you say, well, for 1 week, I'm going to read my Bible every day. Or for 1 week, I'm going to think of a person or a situation and I'm going to pray about that every day. Or I'm really conscious of the whole cost of living crisis and I'm going to get involved in the campaign about that. I'm going to go on the Methodist Church website and I'm going to look at their campaign stuff and I'm going to get involved in that. Or it might be there's somebody in your school who's always on their own at lunchtime and that you decide that for a week, you're going to make a real effort to go and ask them to be part of your games or whatever at lunchtime. Or it might be that you say, the drums are going to fall over. Or it might be that you say, I'm going to go for a walk every day this week, and I'm going to notice God's creation. Or something completely different. What I want you to do is start thinking what the one thing you could do to make a difference because Jesus is in your life this week, just for 1 week. And then Tess is going to come round. What I want you all to do before you start thinking is to get your house keys out. You all just get your house keys out. I'm not going to take them off you, don't panic. Get your house keys out. Tess is going to bring round some string in a minute. Wait a minute, Tess, hang on. And what I want you to do is tie a bit of wool to your house keys so that every time you open the door this week, it annoys you and reminds you that you have chosen for this week to do that one thing. Whatever your one thing is, and it can be big, small, you don't need to tell anyone else one thing, but it reminds you to do that thing. It might be there's somebody you know needs a phone call every day this week, and it's going to remind you to do that. It can be anything, but tie it to your keys, and for a week, it will remind you that you need to do that one thing. Okay, so we're going to have a bit of music, and Tess is going to bring those around. And once you've got your idea, tie that to your keys. Okay, as the last people tie their piece of string to their keys, let's pray before we finish. Jesus, just as you said to Zacchaeus, I want you to welcome me into your life. You say to each of us, I want you to welcome me into your life. And this week, as we say, yes, Jesus, I want you to be part of my life, we want it to make a difference in those little ways that each of us has committed to. So each day this week, as we open our front door, may we remember that having you in our lives makes a radical difference. Amen. We're going to continue praising God now, and I'm just going to look at the music group by singing Lord Jesus Christ. And the words are going to appear on the screen. Thank you. Children or child are now going to leave us for their activities. And then I think Paddy is going to come and read the story of Zacchaeus.
The reading is from Luke chapter 19, verses 1 to 10. Zacchaeus the tax collector. Jesus entered Jericho and was passing through. A man was there by the name of Zacchaeus. He was a chief tax collector and was wealthy. He wanted to see who Jesus was, but because he was short, he could not see over the crowd. So he ran ahead and climbed a sycamore fig tree to see him, since Jesus was coming that way. When Jesus reached the spot, he looked up and said to him, Zacchaeus, come down immediately. I must stay at your house today. So he came down at once and welcomed him gladly. All the people saw this and began to mutter, "He has gone to be the guest of a sinner." But Zacchaeus stood up and said to the Lord, "Look, Lord, here and now I give half of my possessions to the poor. And if I have cheated anybody out of anything, I will pay back four times the amount." Jesus said to him, "Today salvation has come to this house, because this man too is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man came to seek and to save the lost." Amen.
Next reading is taken from Psalm 32, starting at verse 1. "Happy are those whose transgressions is forgiven, whose sin is covered. Happy are those to whom the Lord imputes no iniquity, and in spirit there is no deceit. While I kept silent, my body wasted away through my groaning all day long. But day and night your hand was heavy upon me. My strength was dried up as by the heat of the summer. Then I acknowledged my sin to you. I did not hide my iniquity. I said, I will confess my transgressions to the Lord, and you forgave the guilt of my sin. Therefore, let all who are faithful offer prayer to you. At a time of distress, the rush of mighty waters shall not reach them. You are my hiding place for me. You preserve me from trouble. You surround me."
Can you hear me now? Is that better? Yeah? Right. Good. Right. I have to admit, I was slightly perturbed when it dawned on me that I was going to have to stand up and speak today, as we have no assigned preacher. But then I saw that the main reading was the story of Zacchaeus, the tax collector, who Jesus called down from the sycamore tree. I realised I could relate that to the work of Prison Fellowship. I've been volunteering with Prison Fellowship since June 2018 as a group facilitator on their sycamore tree course in HMP Liverpool Men's Prison in Walton. The course teaches restorative justice and victim awareness and uses the story of Zacchaeus as its... basis, showing how Zacchaeus had a complete heart change after his meeting with Jesus, and not only understood in his heart the error of his ways, but was genuine and sincere in his commitment to make amends to his victims. He was a chief tax collector, working for the Romans, so probably no one dared challenge him when he continually took over and above the due amount of tax from the members of the community and pocketed the extra for himself. While his lifestyle flourished, the community would be kept in poverty with maybe not even enough money for the basics. Probably most of the tax collectors were in the habit of doing this. The tax collectors and sinners are mentioned several times in the Bible as a package. The attitude may well have been, well, the others are all doing it, so why shouldn't I? It must be okay. When we use this story on the sycamore tree course, we first of all get the prisoners or learners to examine the attitude of Zacchaeus towards his victims, and the crime and the harm that was caused, and the short and long-term effects on the victims and the wider community. This would include poverty, which would impact on the children, cause stress and anxiety and poorer health, and affect local shopkeepers because people had less money to spend. We then encourage the learners to look at their own crime and examine the same aspects, particularly the immediate and longer term effects on victims and the wider community. In other words, the ripple effect that their crime has had. This is usually quite an eye-opener for them, realising the wider, far-reaching impact that their crime may have had on the community. The course runs four times a year and lasts for 6 weeks, one afternoon a week. We have actually just finished. We weren't able to go in during lockdown, so we were 2.5 years where the course didn't run in Liverpool anyway. So we have just finished the first course that we've done for 2.5 years. On week three of the course, a victim of crime comes in to talk to the learners. And in Liverpool, we are blessed to have Lynn Connolly, who has dedicated her life to doing this since her son Paul was murdered in 2002, a totally unprovoked attack. Having just got out of a taxi in Anfield, he was approached by two young men asking for a light. When he turned round, they stabbed him in the back. They didn't rob him, they just walked away. They'd been high on drink and drugs all day and were just looking for a victim. It could have been anyone. The taxi driver had seen Paul bending down in his rearview mirror. He thought he was fastening his shoelace, and so he drove off, not realising what had happened. The lady outside whose house this happened writes to Lynn every year on the anniversary. These are the impacts on the wider community. Two young men were caught and sentenced, but have since been out, reoffended, and back in prison again. Neither of them have ever shown any remorse, which must be extremely hard to bear. One of the most powerful messages Lynn puts across when she comes in to speak is that of forgiveness. She and her husband Mick were pastors at a local Christian fellowship church at the time. When they took part in a televised press conference a couple of days after Paul's murder, the reporter asked them, "How do you feel about the two men who did this?" Lynn says she and Mick just looked at each other and they both said, "We forgive them." They hadn't discussed it and they didn't know they were going to say that. Lynn talks very powerfully about how having that forgiveness in her heart benefits her most of all and frees her from carrying around the heavy burden of bitterness, hatred and anger. This is truly remarkable, especially when the offenders have shown no remorse whatsoever. We're now going to watch a short video about the sycamore tree course, in which you will see Lynn. I think the video was made in 2010, so it is a little bit out of date.
The UK prison system is under greater pressure than ever before.
Prison population has increased year on year very dramatically over the last few years. Costs obviously are ever increasing, cost nearly £40,000 to keep someone in prison for a year now. And the rates of reoffending are incredibly high.
Restorative justice is a different way of looking at crime, where offenders and victims are brought together to encourage people to take responsibility for their actions.
There are hundreds and hundreds of people involved in every crime. And so they're really facing that. It's very difficult for them to face those things, the devastation they've caused.
Because I never looked at a victim. I didn't have no victims. I always classed myself as a victim.
Crime actually causes damage and harm in people's lives, and that the response should therefore be to look at what that harm is and what people need to have happen to put that right. Prison Fellowship is a Christian charity supporting the work of chaplaincies in prison, and our courses are run, staffed by and run by volunteers.
Prison Fellowship's Restorative Justice and Victim Awareness Programme is called Sycamore Tree.
The Sycamore Tree is a 6-week course. So in the first week, really that is an introduction for them to restorative justice and comparing it to sort of the justice system that most of them have experienced through imprisonment. In week 3 of the course, the inmates get to meet a victim of crime.
Lynn Connolly's son Paul was murdered in 2002. She's been speaking at Sycamore Tree courses for the last 8 years.
And I've sobbed my way through my story, I think probably every single time, because I'm re-engaging again with the pain of what's happened. But obviously because of the response, to me it's worth it.
And in the midst of that, even though it's very simple, I think there's a lot of emotions and a lot of things for them to process as they kind of face up to the potential impact of their crime on victims.
The victim that came in, I could have so easily been the fellow that robbed her house and tied her son up, and it didn't click until that story.
Then once they've heard from a victim of crime, we start to challenge their own behaviour. We challenge, for example, things like the excuses that they might make for their offending. And not to deny that those things have happened in their past, but to challenge them to put them into a place and then to work from that positively to start to make amends.
And in the final week of the course, it's sort of an opportunity for the participants to express their sorrow and their understanding of what they've done and apologise or in some way make an act of restitution. Way it gives the guys a chance to make a public confession or a public stand that as a result of this course they want their life to be different.
Once the course is over, what we hope is that we've given them a motivation to start perhaps engaging with things both within the prison and once they come outside of the prison that probably typically in the past they won't have engaged with in any way.
And I wrote a letter just to say that I don't think I'd leave any more victims, and 4 years down the line I haven't.
The course is essentially incredibly simple, and that moment of encounter between an offender, albeit within a group, facing a victim of crime, time and again we see has a dramatic impact on people's lives.
And one young man in particular said to me afterwards, "If I'd heard your story years ago, I would never have reoffended." And he said, "Who knows, miss, you could save lives."
So we saw Lynn in that video, the former prisoner who was speaking there, he wasn't referring to Lynn, of course, as the victim of crime in this particular case. But, and this course runs all over the country, and obviously there are lots of victims of crime who go into prisons all over the country. And the course leader there refers to the excuses that offenders make for committing their crime. And one of the aims of the course is to help them to understand that there are reasons why we are the way we are, but excuses are why we stay that way when we know we should change. And a question which is posed to the learners and us on the course is, which do you find harder? To say sorry for something you've done wrong, or to forgive someone who's wronged you? And it's usually almost unanimously agreed that we find it harder to forgive. Prisoners often have various people in their lives who they need to forgive, family members or carers who've let them down or abused them, friends who've betrayed their trust, etc. But they come to realise that they often need to forgive themselves too. This is usually dependent on them experiencing genuine remorse. They realise they want and need the forgiveness of their victims, but they also have to come to a point of forgiving themselves. Otherwise, they are just carrying around that burden of guilt and self-hatred. And now we've got another short video. This was the promotional video for Prisons Week in 2016, and the message is, Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
Lord, have mercy.
God, please help.
In that video, we saw the young offender, the woman who had her bag snatched from her shoulder, and the young boy who was missing his dad in prison. Maybe all three can be seen as victims, because offenders are in a way victims of their own crime, in that they lose their freedom and are separated from family and friends. We may say, well, that's their own fault, but if we can help them onto a path towards a better way of life for the future, so that they're less likely to reoffend and end up back in prison, surely that can only be a good thing. There are usually around 20 men on the course, ranging in age from early 20s to in their 50s. The majority are in their 20s, 30s and 40s. The first time I took part, I looked at this group of men and they just looked incredibly normal. Any one of them could have been my own son or grandson. And interacting with them, I found the majority polite, respectful, and often with a sense of humour. Well, that's no surprise because many of them are from Liverpool or the surrounding area, often on remand and waiting to be sentenced. Many are in for being involved in some way in drug dealing, but they're not the top dogs, usually much lower down the line. Some were in for armed robbery, violence, including domestic violence, arson, and I have met one who was in for murder. Even he was reduced to tears on hearing Lynn's testimony. Many of them have wives or girlfriends and children, and they're torn apart by being separated from their families and their children in particular. On week six, they're encouraged to stand up at the front and make an act of restitution. This is quite often a heartfelt letter of apology to their wife and children or to their mother for the suffering that they've put them through as they come to realise that they are victims too. The men are allowed to have two adult family members present for this last session, the last session. And it's very moving to witness them standing up and making these amends in public, often reduced to tears themselves. During the course, the learners are shown videos of actual and fictional cases of restorative justice where the victim and offender meet. The victim is totally honest about the effects the violent crime had on him, his job, and his family. And the offender needs to hear this honest account, no soft soaping. In this case, there was the full circle of true remorse and forgiveness. The victim reached out to support the offender in his life when he came out of prison. We split off into small groups for some of the course with one or two group facilitators to about five men. As the weeks go on, we get to know them better and build a relationship, and they trust us more. And we find that they're usually wanting to share their story and how they've ended up in prison. Often they're fully aware of what they've done wrong, or that what they've done is wrong, and want to get their lives back on track. But they need help processing it all in their minds and hearts. As our course leader says, it's only 18 inches from head to heart, but it's vital that that jump is made. From understanding and processing something with your mind, to feeling it and experiencing it in your heart. True remorse and forgiveness can only happen in the heart. I have to say that there is something strangely compelling about helping on the Sycamore Tree course. I find it educational and I'm continually learning myself in more ways than one. I feel blessed to work with the other volunteers, to witness their example, their genuineness and the easy, free-flowing relationship they have with God, expressed especially during the short prayer session that we have before the men arrive. I see how important this prayer is in asking the Holy Spirit to be present and working throughout the session, and it really does seem to work. Praying out loud in a group was not something I'd ever done before. I still don't find it easy, but I know I am privileged and blessed to have been placed with these particular volunteers. It's also an education in remembering why I am there and that these are real people's lives we are dealing with. It's a lesson in sincerity and humility. And I continually have to monitor myself to check in on my own attitudes and motives and to make sure I don't get too caught up in any self-congratulation, because it's easy to fall into that. All the volunteers agree that we do all get a positive feel from doing this work. But I certainly have to make sure that my involvement is genuine and to remember that I'm there as God's instrument. Now another video on the general work of Prison Fellowship.
Prison Fellowship are a multi-denominational Christian charity.
Prison Fellowship exists to equip and resource people who want to be involved in prison ministry.
We've been going for about 30 years, and Prison Fellowship exists in about 120 countries around the world.
And I think it started as with a vision to have a prayer group associated with every prison in the country.
I mean, the main thing we do is we try and connect with people in prisons. We try and connect with prisoners through prayer.
Prison Fellowship is largely the fellowship of all the volunteers.
I think as Christians, it's really important to care for everyone.
He loves them just as much as he loves us, and that's something we want to show them.
I think that Prison Fellowship, through its Christian history, if you like, can actually change the lives of prisoners.
It's about coming alongside people and showing them that they're loved and cared for, that there are people in the world who care for them.
There's just something about it that's that just feels quite special to me.
On a whole, prisoners are just the same as everybody else.
They're just like us. They've taken a wrong turn.
Prisoners are just like me, because I was one.
Prayer itself is the key to everything that we do.
We meet once a month. We pray about the issues within that particular prison.
We will look into whether there's a prayer group in your area, or maybe you want to set one up yourself.
Well, letter writing is something that anyone can get involved in. If you've got a little bit of time or a lot of time, you can really make a difference to prisoners' lives.
If you imagine somebody in prison feeling completely isolated, they may have come from a broken family, they may not have their own family outside. So as an individual, they could be incredibly lonely inside.
And they also do the Angel Tree project.
Angel Tree, well, it's simple. Angel Tree is about God unwrapped.
Angel Tree is run both at Christmas, and we're currently running some over Mother's Day as well.
It's designed to help prisoners and their families at home.
We provide presents for offenders' children.
Then we send them out to the different families.
A Sycamore Tree is a six-part course.
It's a restorative justice course, which is faith-based but not faith-promoting.
Restorative justice focuses on who has been injured or hurt or damaged by a crime.
I think restorative justice is the long-term solution.
The thing that's really surprised me actually is the openness and the honesty of the inmates.
In 6 weeks I've seen women completely turn around in their life.
It made me do a lot of self-reflection and it kind of helped me to forgive myself.
We can't achieve what we want to achieve and what we're trying to achieve without people helping us on the front line.
If you're a person of faith, you are welcome.
When it works, people can go on and achieve in their lives, and I'm a testament to how that's worked.
Our volunteers are literally the backbone of what we do.
People, once they start volunteering with us, they can't seem to stop.
Please log onto our website and have a look at our volunteer application form. Please fill that in. We'll get in touch with you with various ways that you can get involved.
Prison Fellowship's vision is that every prisoner has access to support and prayer. To find out how you can help us, go to www.prisonfellowship.org.uk.
You see, Prison Fellowship does run other things apart from the Sycamore Tree course. The Angel Tree, which it referred to there, enables prisoners to send a gift to their child at Christmas with a personal message. The prisoner tells us the age and sex of the child and the sort of toys they like. Volunteers give money. The presents are bought, wrapped and delivered to the children through the prisons. And they now do also a similar thing on Mother's Day. Prayer line was started up during lockdown, since that video was made, whereby prisoners ring a free phone line funded by Prison Fellowship and leave their prayer request on an answering machine. A trained member of PF listens to the message and then transposes it into a text or WhatsApp message, making sure it's anonymous, and the messages are sent out to the PF WhatsApp groups throughout the country who commit to pray. And then we have letter link, whereby a prisoner can write to a member of PF. And I've been doing this for about 2 years. We cannot be identified, so we use an alias, and all the letters go via the PF office. We're not allowed to write to anyone local or to see a photo of each other, or to meet, or keep in touch after the offender has left prison. Again, I find this rewarding, but also a challenge. I just have to hope that I am able to provide some degree of support for someone who may be suffering mental health issues and being cut off by family and friends with no contact or being bullied by other inmates, and a lot of that goes on. Mainly I focus on being supportive and positive, trying to relay anything of interest or humour from my own life, but also sometimes trying to nudge the recipient towards
looking at their own offence and accepting responsibility, especially if they're in total denial and blaming other people, you know, saying other people lied, etc. So, and this is a tricky path, one I have trod very warily, as when you've never met a person, it's pretty difficult to determine from a letter how much is the truth, and how much are they deceiving themselves, and how much are they just playing for sympathy and manipulating you. And I have been warned that they are often very manipulative. But rather than risk making someone's mental health worse or alienating them altogether, I usually err on the side of caution and try to just be supportive and a listening ear more than anything. I'm trying to give a Christian example. Right, so that's the end. There is, yes, if you're interested, there is the website address, prisonfellowship.org.uk, for any more information. If you're seriously interested or know anybody who might be, there is an online event this coming Thursday, I think it is Thursday, the 3rd of November. I think it's on Zoom, 2 p.m. Repeated at 7:30 in the evening. You have to register. So the address is there. Just prison.org. Join us. Right. What's next? We're now going to sing "Seek Ye First the Kingdom of God." Charlie is going to read the prayers of intercession for us.
And there is a response. When I say, "Have mercy, Lord," can you all say, "Have mercy"? So, "Have mercy, Lord, have mercy." Let us pray. God of grace, we pray for those who are overlooked, those who weep behind closed doors, those without a champion for their cause. Have mercy, Lord. Have mercy. We pray for those whose minds hold hidden terrors, who cannot voice the pain they feel within, and those who struggle with everyday tasks. Have mercy, Lord. We pray for those who feel the blows of cruelty, for those for whom injustice is the norm, and those whose lives are marred by persecution. Have mercy, Lord. Lord, there are many people today who, like Zacharias, are lining the pockets at other people's expense. We pray for them, that the hearts will be touched and changed by encountering your life-changing spirit. We pray for all victims of financial fraud and dishonesty. We pray for all enduring dark times, for all who can see no way out. May the leaders of your church encourage and build in your name, offering hope where there is none. May your church shine a light on our communities and reach out to all, including those whom society views as unpopular. Have mercy, Lord. Lord, when you called to Zacharias, he gladly welcomed you to his home. His meeting with you brought about inward and outward change. We pray for change to be wrought in your world, in our nation, in us, you created ones. Have mercy, Lord. God of grace, surround all for whom we pray with love and care today, that peace and hope may spring from unexpected places. Have mercy, Lord. Now can we all say the Lord's Prayer together? Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Charlie. I'm now going to take up the offering. Thank you. And I'm going to sing again, Let Us Build a House.
Sending out prayer. Thank you, Jesus, for being with us today and every day in our noisy, busy lives. We pray that we may hear you calling our names and make the effort to see your face in the crowd. Amen. Shall we say the grace together? May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit
Be with us all now, evermore. Amen.